Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Alhamdulillahirrahmanirrahim. Thanks God. Today, we are praying to Allah because Alhamdulillah we can meet again in the good heart, in the good condition, in the virtual meeting related to the subject of Indonesian history in the colonial period. In the colonial time, and starting our lecture today, let's be reciting together basmalah. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Today we are going to listen to the student presentation. There are the four students who already attending the PowerPointers, namely Hani S. Hasana, and then Melissa, and then Iklima S. Tanjung, and finally Salma Febriani. Every student will present the four pointers in 5 minutes maximum. And I would like to give opportunity personally to Hani S. Hasana. Hani, your time is 5 minutes, please. Hello, Hani. I give you the opportunity. You didn't listen to me. If you didn't respond in 5 seconds, in 1 minute, maybe I will escape and replaced by other student. Hello, honey. Okay, 1 minute. Okay, if you didn't respond my suggestion. Please ready, Melissa. Melissa, your time also 5 minutes, please. Wait, Melissa, wait. Melissa, 5 minutes for you, please. Honey, please, 5 minutes. Honey. Do you listen my voice, Hani and Melissa? Salma, do you listen my voice, Salma?
Hello.
Please, go ahead. Aduh, kumaha itu barolot kia masih sate. Go ahead, Hani. Go ahead. Do you know? Go ahead. Teruskan. Woi.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Saya kenalkan. Okay. You
halo.
Just three
minutes. Suara aku udah masuk belum Iklima? Halo. Iklima. Oke. Di sini saya akan menjelaskan mengenai strategi perlawanan Pumat terhadap penjajahan Belanda di Aceh tahun 1873 sampai 1899. Di sini ada biografi mengenai Teuku Umar dan latar belakang Perang Aceh. Nah, tapi saya akan melanjutkan ke strategi Teuku Umar pada Perang Aceh melawan kolonial Belanda karena berhubung dengan waktu yang sangat singkat. Nah, yang seperti kita ketahui pada tahun 1873 Masehi awal mula Perang Aceh, saat itu Teuku Umar masih berusia 19 tahun, tapi dia sudah mulai mengikuti perang gitu. Dimulai dari kampung halamannya sedia yaitu Mabeloh. Lanjut ke 1880 dia berhasil memukul mundur Belanda dari Patek, yaitu pelabuhan dekat Mabeloh, lalu 1882 mengusir Belanda dari Kreweng Rabu, dan mendirikan pos Aceh di sana, juga pos Belanda dekat Bukit Sigun. Tapi pada tahun 1883, Teuku Umar dan pasukannya menyerahkan diri. Hal ini merupakan siasat Teuku Umar yang bertujuan untuk mendapatkan senjata dari Belanda gitu. Nah, di tahun 1883 juga ada peristiwa penempatan waktunya salah, peristiwa Nisaya pada tahun 1883 yaitu tenggelamnya kapal Inggris. Nah, di sini tuh Teuku Umar diminta oleh Belanda untuk menebus para awak kapal yang disandra oleh Raja Tenom. Nah, tetapi Teuku Umar malah mengambil uang tersebut. Lalu di pada tahun 1891, Tuku Cipiro itu meninggal. Nah, selain itu juga Smokwe Gonje ditugaskan di Aceh dan juga Pantezen diganti oleh Dayakolot. Itu tuh apa sih? Panglima gubernur militernya diganti. Nah, Dayakolot ini tuh punya rencana buat lebih dekat ke Aceh gitu, untuk perdamaian ke Aceh. Nah, hal tersebut tuh tidak disia-siakan Tuku Umar. Tuku Umar tuh melakukan perdamaian lagi dengan Aceh. Nah, di sana tuh Tuku Umar diperintahkan untuk ditugaskan melayani musuh Belanda di Aceh, yaitu ulai balang gitu kan. Nah, zolim terhadap rakyatnya seperti itu. Nah, di tahun 1896.
Oke, Hani, your time is over. Please close your screen.
Tepatnya 28 Maret.
Hello, Hani, your time is over. Oke. Okay, the next presenter is Melissa. Melissa, did you listen my voice? Please, your time is 5 minutes. Nggak dengar lagi. Gimana ini? Admin, tolong di-toel eta Melissa, kalah ke bengong. 5 minutes, Melissa, your time, please.
Bapak, sebentar. Ini mau share screen dulu.
Your microphone unmute. Please open your microphone in order you can speak in microphone, Melissa. 5 minutes, okay? Aduh, barolot kia, pahingan di komentaranku dosen tetara didengi, da. Dosennya riosnya teka kuping rupinanya. Oke, 1 menit ya. Kalau 1 menit belum saja ngomong, diganti dengan yang lain.
Baik, assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Saya Melissa dengan NIM 2108943. Saat ini saya akan menjelaskan tentang keterikatan petani dan petinggi di Priangan pada tahun 1720 sampai 1870. Nah, sebelumnya saya akan menjelaskan dulu nih tentang kayak perkembangan petani dari masa ke masa. Nah, pada masa awal petani gitu. Petani itu masih istilahnya itu petani petani itu masih petani pengembara. Jadi petani itu menanam padi itu dari suatu tempat ke tempat lain itu berbeda gitu. Lalu yang kedua, munculnya petani tipar. Nah, petani tipar ini tuh masih dalam kategori petani bertindak, tapi peralatannya tuh masih canggih. Terus juga dia tuh masih udah bisa membuat rumah untuk ditinggali 5 sampai 7 tahun. Nah, selanjutnya kedudukan petani tipar ini tuh digeser oleh petani sawah, karena pada saat itu tuh di Priangan tuh sudah mulai ada pembukaan lahan pesawahan oleh bangsawan dan juga dibantu oleh pemerintah kolonial VOC, dan akhirnya tuh banyak itu petani yang beralih menjadi petani menetap. Nah, ketika petani menetap ini tuh, petani itu akan diberikan kayak semacam perlindungan hukum dan juga perlindungan dan lainnya. Tapi di samping itu tuh petani itu juga mendapatkan pembebanan kerja yang lebih berat, karena petani itu diharuskan memberikan sebagian hasil panennya itu kepada petinggi gitu. Dan akhirnya gitu, mau tidak mau si pemilik lahan ini tuh harus mengajak anggota keluarganya dan juga mempekerjakan petani penyakap atau buruh untuk ikut mengelola sawahnya gitu. Nah, walaupun gitu si hasilnya itu lebih banyak, tetapi karena penyerahan paksa kepada sebagian besar ini tuh si surplus dari panen tuh nggak ada artinya gitu. Nah, pembuatan sawah juga memudahkan untuk pemangkasan surplus agraris maupun pengikatan petani sebagai bawahan. Jadi dapat disimpulkan bahwa si hubungan antara petinggi dan petani itu dipahami itu hanya sebagai hubungan atasan dan bawahan. Mengabdi berarti petani itu memilih untuk mencari perlindungan pada seseorang terkemuka atau ngelindung istilahnya. Selain itu tuh merupakan suatu kehormatan pada saat itu menjadi pengabdi pada seorang berpengaruh dan melayaninya. Sedangkan sebaliknya gitu, si pejabat tinggi atau para bangsawan ini tuh dapat meningkatkan pengaruhnya karena kekayaan seorang bupati itu terlihat dari jumlah tangan yang bersedia melayaninya. Nah, dalam upayanya mendapatkan pengaruh dan dibawa dengan cara mengikat petani sebagai abdinya pada bangsawan ini. Setempat itu didukung oleh VOC, karena VOC kan sejak awal tuh yang mendorong perluasan pertanian tepat dan memerintahkan para kepala untuk mengakhiri perpindahan petani. Tetapi gitu sih, kayak apa ya, kayak pemungutan hasil pertanian ini tuh nggak langsung ke bupati langsung, tetapi ada tahapan-tahapannya, yaitu melalui kepala-kepala rendahan.
Oke, Melissa, your time is over.
Ya, mungkin sekian dari saya. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Salam. Oke, the next presenter is Iklima Z. Tanjung. Iklima, similar, your time also 5 minutes, please.
Sebelumnya terima kasih kepada Pak Andi Sumirto yang telah mengizinkan saya untuk melakukan presentasi pada hari ini. Hari ini saya akan membacakan sebuah presentasi, yaitu implikasi politik liberal Netherlands terhadap sistem perekonomian Hindia Belanda 1870 sampai tahun 1900. Jadi kita mulai dari perkembangan politik liberal di Netherlands dulu. Pergolakan politik di Perancis tahun 1848 ini telah menyebabkan liberalisme menguat di Perancis. Jadi saat itu tuh dipimpin oleh Louis Philippe yang turun tahta pada Februari 1848. Nah, kaum revolusioner memimpin pemerintahan untuk sementara, dan Republik Prancis akhirnya mengadopsi sebuah motto, yaitu Liberté, Égalité, dan Fraternité, yang artinya kemerdekaan, persamaan, dan persaudaraan. Hingga gema liberalisme mulai menyebar ke negara-negara tetangganya, termasuk Netherlands. Nah, setelah kaum liberal Belanda menang di politik parlemen, akhirnya diterapkanlah sebuah asas liberalisme, di mana tak berselang lama, Regeringsreglement 1854 dihasilkan di Netherlands. Yang Regeringsreglement ini merupakan dasar dari prinsip liberal, yaitu kebebasan individu dan keamanan hak-hak dan usaha. Jadi Regeringsreglement ini dalam bahasa Indonesia artinya adalah perubahan aturan, di mana terdapat pengurangan pada kekuasaan raja karena campur tangan dari Staten General atau parlemen, yang saat itu parlemen itu dipegang sama pihak liberal. Jadi sekarang tuh kekuasaan tidak pada raja saja gitu, tapi ada pembagian, yaitu parlemen. Berbagai kritik sosial menjelang 1860 ini menjadi faktor pendorong kemenangan golongan liberal di Netherlands, salah satunya oleh seorang tokoh yaitu Edward Douwes Dekker, yang menyuarakan protesnya dengan mengeluarkan buku yaitu Max Havelaar atau Maltatuli. Selanjutnya adalah Undang-Undang Agraria 1870 yang menjadi awal ekonomi liberal di Hindia Belanda. Kalau misalnya kita tahu Undang-Undang Agraria ini ada di 1870, di mana dengan penghapusan kultur stelsel dan menjadikan pijakan awal bagi modal swasta. Nah, ini untuk pertama kalinya dalam sejarah kolonial, modal swasta itu diberikan peluang sepenuhnya untuk menjalankan usaha di Indonesia. Seperti perkebunan-perkebunan besar di Jawa, di luar Jawa, itu semua diatur dalam Undang-Undang Agraria, yang memungkinkan pengusaha Eropa untuk menyewa tanah kepada penduduk setempat. Meskipun Belanda dan swasta Eropa mendirikan perkebunan, tetap didasari pada Undang-Undang Agraria ini. Jadi, hak petani itu masih memiliki haknya atas tanah, dan juga tidak usah ketakutan dalam kehilangan tanahnya. Selanjutnya adalah penanaman modal di Indonesia, terutama pada industri gula, timah, tembakau, itu mulai berkembang sejak 1855. Di mana tidak hanya tanah, tapi impor barang pun terjadi di saat ini gitu. Hingga penemuan mesin uap yang membuat revolusi industri semakin pesat, di mana terdapat pergantian tenaga kerja dari manusia ke tenaga mesin yang membuat waktu produksi menjadi lebih singkat, sehingga membuat kebutuhan akan bahan mentah menjadi naik. Nah, akan bahan mentah inilah yang dibahas, di mana bahan mentah ini ada di Indonesia, yaitu batu bara. Dengan demikian, politik liberal ini yang semula menghendaki liberalisme tanah jajahan, lalu politik ini berkembang menjadi bagaimana mengatur tanah jajahan untuk memperoleh uang. Selanjutnya adalah krisis ekonomi 1881 dan 1896. Krisis ekonomi ini terjadi sempat membuat produksi dalam negeri kelimpungan. Baru setelah 1896, produksi seperti kopi mengalami momen recovery. Kendati demikian, upah yang terlanjur turun serta penutupan pabrik di era krisis menyebabkan kesejahteraan rakyat tidak mengalami peningkatan meskipun telah mengalami masa krisis ekonomi. Jadi saat ini tuh meskipun krisis ekonominya sudah lewat, tapi upah-upah para pegawai ini tetap sama gitu saat seperti krisis ekonomi. Jadi tidak ada kenaikan yang signifikan gitu. dan kemakmuran rakyat ditentukan oleh perbandingan jumlah penduduk dan faktor-faktor seperti tanah, modal, dan dilihat di sini rakyat Jawa ini bermodal sangat sedikit, sedangkan jumlah penduduk sangat besar. Segitu Pak kurang lebihnya.
Okay, thank you very much, Iklima J. Tanjung. The last presenter is Salma Febriani. Salma, can you allow your time also 5 minutes, please?
Baik Bapak, apakah suara saya terdengar?
Nah,
baik. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Saya Salma Febriani dengan NIM 2108366. Sebelumnya terima kasih kepada Bapak Anies Wirta yang telah memberikan saya kesempatan untuk mempresentasikan topik yang saya pilih, yang berjudul Hindia Belanda Masa Liberal, Undang-Undang Agraria dan Dampaknya Terhadap Penduduk Hindia Belanda tahun 1870 sampai 1900. Dimulai dari latar belakang lahirnya Undang-Undang Agraria. Nah, latar belakang lahirnya Undang-Undang Agraria tidak terlepas dari menyebarnya paham liberal di Eropa yang muncul akibat adanya pergolakan politik yang terjadi di Eropa yang dimulai di Prancis pada tahun 1848 yang tadi sudah dipaparkan oleh dipaparkan lebih lengkap oleh presenter Iklima. Nah, ide-ide liberalisme menyebar ke berbagai kawasan di Eropa tidak terkecuali di Belanda. Pada tahun 1850-an, selain golongan liberal yang menghendaki dilaksanakannya kegiatan perdagangan yang terbebas gitu dari campur tangan pemerintah, ada juga golongan humanis gitu yang menilai bahwa sistem kultur stelsel ini tidak berperi kemanusiaan dan membuat pribumi menderita. Nah, akibat adanya tekanan dari golongan-golongan tersebut gitu, pemerintah Belanda mengeluarkan Undang-Undang Agraria tahun 1870. Nah, jadi di Undang-Undang Agraria ini memastikan gitu bahwa tanah penduduk itu dijamin, sementara tanah tak bertuan adalah hak milik negara kolonial, pemerintah kolonial. Nah, kepemilikan tanah ini diatur dalam keputusan yang dinamakan dengan domain verklaring. Nah, domain verklaring ini domain verklaring itu, nah, baik tanah pribumi maupun tanah pemerintah itu dapat disewa oleh pihak swasta, yang dimana pemerintah Belanda ini memberikan hak erpak atau hak guna usaha yang diberikan kepada pemodal asing gitu untuk bisa menyewa tanah pemerintah hingga 75 tahun dan juga tanah rakyat hingga 30 tahun. Selanjutnya ke penyelewengan Undang-Undang Agraria. Namun pada kenyataannya, tanah-tanah milik pribumi bisa diperjualbelikan. Caranya yaitu dengan pribumi ini melepaskan hak milik atas tanahnya tersebut. Dan pemerintah Belanda mengganti hak tersebut dengan berupa uang gitu. Jadi ini tuh mirip dengan menjual tanah gitu. Nah, karena hak milik atas tanah tersebut itu sudah tidak ada, maka tanah tersebut itu merupakan tanah tak bertuan, yang mana tanah tak bertuan adalah tanah pemerintah Belanda, tanah pemerintah kolonial yang nantinya bisa disewakan kepada pihak swasta. Oleh karena tanah-tanah tersebut disewakan kepada pemodal-pemodal asing untuk dibuka menjadi perkebunan, hal ini menyebabkan banyaknya tanah yang subur dijadikan sebagai perkebunan dan pertanian yang ditanami oleh tanaman ekspor. Sedangkan lahan untuk menanam tanaman pangan itu berkurang. Puncak penderitaan rakyat terjadi ketika adanya krisis yang terjadi pada tahun 1885, di mana harga komoditi perkebunan menurun drastis. Nah, hal ini memberikan dampak yang buruk gitu karena banyak rakyat pribumi yang bekerja sebagai buruh perkebunan dibayar dengan upah yang kecil, belum lagi meningkatnya penduduk di Hindia Belanda yang memperburuk tingkat kemiskinan dan juga pengangguran di Hindia Belanda, serta kurangnya bahan pangan karena tanah yang subur banyak dijadikan perkebunan oleh pihak swasta. Di samping dampak negatif, ada juga beberapa dampak positif seperti diperkenalkannya sistem upah, perluasan area perhubungan seperti jalan raya, dan juga dibangunnya irigasi dan lain sebagainya. Mungkin sekian yang dapat saya paparkan. Mohon maaf apabila banyak kesalahan. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam. Okay, thank you very much. Salma Febriani. And for other students who didn't present the PPT today, please you also make the brief comment and then sending directly to the WhatsApp group, okay? Not waiting until me finish in making the comment also, okay? Okay, my comment, I think it is still similar. Most of the presenter, most of the student are still descriptively in explaining something. Even they ask the chronologically, chronicle, okay? Such as the year 19 or the year 1884, they ask the event, 1887, that's the event. I think there's no history, that's the chronicle method, okay? So history is not chronic, but should be explaining about the cause and effect. I think it's very important, okay? Including also, I think, about the standard history book, please ensure that your topic is using the standard historical book, including also in writing about the authors or editors of the standard book, should be exactly right, okay, not wrong. I would like to show to you about the reference in which you are wrong in writing about the reference, okay? Okay, firstly, I would like to make the comment to Hani Hasanah. Hani, I think your explanation is chronic in history. So historical study is not chronic explanation, okay? Not tahun sekian terjadi ini, tahun sekian terjadi ini, tahun. I think that's the chronic. There are no history, okay? So in history should be analysis deeply about the cause and effect. You should be analysis about the Baljerpi, for example, Teku Umar and other Aceh fighter, okay, in fighting versus the Dutch colonial government. Okay, so I think your title, okay, that's the historical title. Although about using about the strategy, I think strategy is the modern terminology. This is maybe using by the Dutch colonial government, including also the army, the military, Dutch government, because such as the Indonesian traditional fighter, Teku Umar, Diponegoro, Imam Bonjol, that's not strategy, because strategy is the modern terminology. I think it is enough if you using the title about the perlawanan Teku Umar, okay? Because the strategy, I think you cannot show to us also how the Teku Umar strategy, because strategy is the modern terminology using by the Dutch colonial government, okay? Okay, you're explaining that chronic, descriptively, not yet analysis cause and effect. And you didn't also analyze about the Tractate of London, okay? I think it is very important, because Tractate of London in 1871, that's divided between the territory of the Britain in Malay Peninsula and the territory of Dutch colonial government in Sumatra. So I think it is very important, because of that, the Dutch colonial government can expand their territory until to the northern Sumatra. And in this context, the Dutch colonial government should be pacified, should be intervene about the Aceh territory based on the Tractate of London, okay? London Convention, London Tractate, London Agreement, and so on and so forth. A new agreement in 1870-1871, I think, should be analyzed, okay? And you didn't also analyze who the Teku Umar, okay? Should be analyzed, because this is the central figure in fighting the Dutch colonial government. Maybe you didn't understand the differences in the title in Aceh between, for example, Teku and Tengku. Honey, do you listen my voice? Okay. Could you answer what different the title between, for example, Teku and Tengku? Teku Umar. What different meaning between the title of Teku and Tengku? Honey.
Kalau teku itu Pak dari tulenan bangsawan, kalau tengku itu dari tulenan kayak lebih keagamaan kayak gitu Pak.
Okay, good. So you should analyze that the Teku Umar comes from noble society, noble class, not from the cleric class. Okay, not from the Islamic scholar. Because of that, the struggle of Teku Umar with other Aceh fighter, particularly Tengku, looks different. So should be analysis the differences between Teku and Tengku in Aceh society. And you also should be analysis. I think it is very important why Aceh was pacified by the Dutch colonial government, because the Dutch colonial government had the Marsose army, tentara Marsose, okay? Marsose army. Consisted the members, if not all from the Dutch or European countries, but come also from native people, particularly people from Jawa, Madura, Manado, Ambon. I think members of Marsose army who pacified also Aceh. So should be analysis about the Marsose army, okay? And finally, I think it's very important, Aceh can be pacified by the Dutch colonial government because the role of the Christian Tenugru Gronje in researching, in studying about the Aceh, and then making the recommendation to the Dutch colonial government that to pacify Aceh should be differentiation between Islam as the religion and Islam as the political power. Yeah. So I think it should be analysis. You're explaining not chronologically, tahun sekian terjadi ini, tahun sekian terjadi ini. I think that's not history. Okay? Should analysis in how the Teku Umar and other Aceh fighter struggle against the Dutch colonial government, including also how, I think strategy here is for the Dutch colonial government, not for Teku Umar. How the strategy of Dutch colonial government to pacify the Aceh, one of the strategy is sending Christian Tenugru Gronje to research, to study about the Aceh community, Aceh society, and recommended to the colonial government. Okay, honey? And your reference, there's the five sources. Okay, but please ensure that in writing about a reference should be right, okay, not wrong. For example, you said that the editor or the author of the Sejarah Nasional Indonesia, you write just Pusponegoro Awansela. There's two authors or two editors, okay, honey? Not only Marwati Husnadi Pusponegoro, but also Nugroho Noto Susanto, okay? So please, should be completely in writing about the authors and editors of the book. Yeah? Jangan pengarangnya dua ditulis satu, gimana ini teh? You also using about the Bahelo thesis. Your title in the Bahasa Indonesia, okay? I think please, if your title in the Bahasa Indonesia, that you should be right, tes skripsi sarjana tidak diterbitkan, okay? Do you know Bachelor? Bachelor is in English undergraduate thesis, not Bachelor. But in Indonesian language, skripsi sarjana tidak diterbitkan and should be italic. Do you know italic? Ani, what is italic? Harus digaris miring ya, skripsi sarjana tidak
ya,
disebutkannya. Oke okay, ya, and I think should be added by other standard sources because if we talk about the Aceh war against the Dutch colonial government, there's the Paul Panvier about the Aceh Orloh, okay? The War of Aceh or Aceh War. I think you also should be read about the Senukurugronya book related to his study, his research about the Aceh Society. Kumpulan karangan nasihat-nasihat Senukurugronya, okay? Should be searching in the Google. And at least I think Reclap should be also read because it is very important. Okay, so should be added your reference in order you can understand about the Teku Umar and others as a fighter in struggling against the Dutch colonial government. Okay, ini itu yang.
Iya Pak. Iya Pak.
Okay, the next is Melissa. Melissa, I think, okay, your title is historical title, but should be elaborate and what the meaning of petinggi here. I think not yet clear. And you should be understand about this system of colonial government, the Dutch colonial government system in Indonesia. I think what the petinggi here, I think it should be clear. Because as you know that the Dutch colonial government system in Indonesia is indirect rule. Hello, Melissa, do you understand indirect rule? Indirect rule meaning, so the Dutch colonial government govern this country from the center as the governor general until assistant resident. Okay, until residency. Meanwhile, from bupati, camat, pati, jaksa, lurah, all is native people. Melissa, do you listen my explanation? Do you understand? Where is Melissa?
Yeah.
Okay, okay. So, petinggi, who is petinggi here? The Dutch, colonial government, all native people. I think because indirect rule, so from bupati, patih, jaksa, camat, lurah, all is native people. Semuanya orang pribumi. Bukan orang Belanda, orang Belandanya sampai ke residenan. Sampai asisten residen. So please you ensure that petinggi here is the native people, not the Dutch colonial government. Because the Dutch colonial government system is indirect rule. Okay? And your explanation is also still descriptively, not yet analysis, cause and effect. Okay, should be understand about the system of government of the Dutch colonial in Indonesia, indirect rule, not direct rule. So from governor general, resident, assistant resident, controller. Control here is supervise the bupati, the native people official, okay? Because of that, I think the relationship between the farmer and what is the thing in English, farmer and official, I think not yet clear, okay? Should be, and I think your reference is based on Jan Bremen is good. Yes, the expert about the history of plantation in Indonesia, including also in Priangan, in West Java. But please, not just one sources, just Jan Bremen, but also should be added by other sources. Nina Herina Lubis, I think, writing about the history of West Java, history of Tatar Sunda, should be also using for analyzing about the what is formal and official in West Java. Including also, I think if you want to know about the development of culture and language, including also, I think, the agriculture in West Java, should be read about the Professor Mikihiro Moriyama's book, okay? Zaman Baru, translate in the Bahasa Indonesia. Moriyama, Professor Mikihiro Moriyama from Japan, who expert about the history and culture of Sunda, Sundanese culture, Sundanese language, Sundanese history. Professor Moriyama was expert. Okay, Melissa, please writing something and you searching in the Google, okay? Not bengong.
Yeah, Pak.
And then should be using also reflect book. I think it's very important. As in I, Indonesian National History, and IDAT, okay? Indonesia in the historical mainstream. I think it is very important. Not just one sources. Jan Bremen is okay, but I think should be added by other historical sources, okay? The next, Iklima Z. Tanjung. I think your title was what is change or modify from the red sentence to the black sentence. However, your title is the historical title, but not only Iklima, but also I think similar with the Salma. Okay, I think about the liberal here, it should be clear. Liberal here, I think not in political matters, but in economy matters. Okay, I think it is very important because as we know that in managing about the economy matters, from for example, I think culture style or cultivation system, I think it is step-owned planning, but although cultivation system or culture sector giving more benefit to the Dutch colonial government, but should be changed the government to the liberal economy. In this case, I think the land, the area in Indonesia in which monopolized by the Dutch colonial government or owned by the government can rent to the private sector, okay? Private enterprise. So I think it should be understand about the liberal here is not in econ, not in, mean in political matter, but in economic matter. Okay? However, your explanation is still descriptively. I think okay about the politics. Politics is not liberal. Politics is still authoritarian, okay? But in liberal, by the agrarian law, Undang-Undang Agraria, they are giving the opportunity, particularly for the private sector, okay, to rent, menyewa, okay, to rent the land owned by the Dutch colonial government. Okay? I don't know about the economic crisis in 1881 to 1896 because I think for the Dutch colonial government about the economic crisis is just no problem. What is important is the private sector can giving the money to the government. Okay, so I think about the economic crisis in 1881 to 1896 maybe not too important for the Dutch colonial government. Okay. Okay, but the reference you mentioned about two sources. However, in writing is still wrong. Please check Iklima about the Indonesia dalam aur sejarah. I think the editors in general is just two person, Taufik Abdullah and Adrian Delapian. Okay. And you added about the Nata. Who is Nata? Please you check in the Indonesia dalam arus sejarah, okay? Should be right in and not wrong in writing about the authors and editor, okay?
Baik, Pak.
I think if you want to understand about the cultivation system or culture style, replaced by the liberal economy policy, should be using also about the Faneuil book, system, what is cultivation system, okay, cultural system, and also Pasir, C.A. Pasir, I think similar about the cultivation system, And Jan Breman, I think Jan Breman is expert about the history of plantation in Indonesia, not only in West Java, but also in North Sumatra. So I think the Jan Breman book is very important to using for your people, because particularly about the liberal economy history, it's very important related to the plantation sector, yeah. Including also the history of economy in Indonesia, TKNV should be searching also in the Google. And I have read also an article and published in the Historia Journal about the plantation in East Sumatra, in North Sumatra, in the time of Dutch colonial government. Please searching Andi Swirtas article related to the plantation history in the North Sumatra. Okay, and the O'Malley is the historian of economy from Australia, who expert also in the history of economy in the time of Dutch colonial government to the Indonesian modern. Okay, so please also searching about the O'Malley. Okay, the last is Salma Febriani. Similar, your title also modify. However, similar with Iklima, okay? So your title is historical title, good. However, liberal here is not in political matters, but in economy matter, okay? Matters, okay? And your explanation is still descriptively, even a black and white perspective, okay? The Dutch is bad, the native people is good. I think please we analyze this in academic matters, not making the judgment in history, okay? So analyzing in cause and effect, it is not yet more analyzing. I think about the agrarian law, it is very important. The core concept about the agrarian law is that if in the territory of Indonesia, for example, there are no kingdom, no native kingdom, no native sultanate, and then this territory will become owned by the Dutch colonial government. Okay, so should be understood. Jadi konsep inti undang-undang agraria itu, kalau di daerah itu tidak ada kerajaan, maka daerah itu, wilayah itu, tanah itu milik pemerintah kolonial Belanda. It is showing in the Priangan area. As we know that in West Java, there are no kingdom. Because the Pajajaran kingdom was collected in the 16th, 17th centuries. The Banten also collapsed. The Cirebon also became the little kingdom. Because of that, the Priangan area directly owned by the Dutch colonial government. It is different if in this area available all access about the native kingdom, for example, in Yogyakarta, in Surakarta. Okay? Because of that, the land, the territory still owned by the native kingdom. So should be understand about the core concept of agrarian law. In order you didn't understand that all territory in Indonesia, all land in Indonesia owned by the Dutch colonial government. No. The territory owned by the Dutch colonial government, if in that area not exist about the native kingdom. Okay. Okay, Salma, do you understand?
Yeah, Bapak.
Okay. So I think the impact of agrarian law also not yet analysis, and your analysis of perspective is still black and white. I think it is not good for the candidate of a historian or history educator. Okay. And you reference also there's the three sources. However, okay, Salma, you write reclaim DKK. What is DKK? please answer in writing in academic matter should be in universal, not in local matters. Okay. What DKK here, Salma? Reclap DKK. What DKK here?
Itu Pak. Jadi ada tiga itunya, ada empat kalau nggak salah.
How many authors?
Empat Bapak kalau nggak salah. Sebentar.
Yeah, I ask to you, what the meaning of DKK here?
Jadi dan kawan-kawannya Bapak.
Okay, I think it is the local terminology. Please, you should be using about the universal terminology, okay? If the authors consisted of three authors called 3%, please should be writing full authors. If the authors are 3%, should be writing all. Okay, Salma, do you understand? Kalau penulisnya itu tiga orang, harus ditulis semua.
Ya, baik Bapak.
But if more than 3%, three authors, please you write the first author and then not DKK, but at all. At all, okay? I think it is international terminology. DKK. Aduh, karunya ke kene. What is DKK? Okay? So, should be at all. Reclap at all. If the authors more than 3%. Three authors, okay? Jadi kalau reclap tuh pengarangnya tiga orang, tiga-tiganya tulis. Tapi kalau empat orang, boleh reclap at all. Jangan DKK ya, apa DKK. Including also, you read about Noto Susanto DKK. I think, as in I, writing by 2% or in the early edition, 3%, should be writing full. Not only Nugroho Noto Susanto DKK. Okay, Salma? As in I, edited by Marwati Junaidi Puspenegoro and Nugroho Noto Susanto. Two editors. In the first edition, three authors, Kartono Kartodirjo, Marwati Junaidi Puspenegoro, and Nugroho Noto Susanto. Should be written full. All authors. Because 3%. Okay? If more than 3%, yang lain dengar nggak ini? Jangan-jangan bolot semua ini ya. If more than 3%, you write Andi Syurta et al. With Salma Febriani et al. If the authors more than 3%. Okay, Salma, do you understand?
Iya, Bapak.
Okay, ya. And similar, I think, with about the editors of Indonesia dalam arus sejarah. Please check. I think there's just 2%. Taufik Abdullah and Adrian Belapian. Okay, you edit with the Nata. Who is Nata here? I don't understand. Okay, I think should be edit also. If similar with the Iklima. Okay, if you want to understand about the culture, style, history, or cultivation system history, should be read also the Vanille books, the Sivasser. Bremen, Jan Bremen should be also used. Tikuanyi and my article in the Historia, the history of plantation in North or East Sumatra and Omalay. Okay, please do searching in the internet. Okay, so I think it is very important not only using the standard history book, but also in writing about the authors, about the editors, it's very important. Please ensure that in writing authors or editors, you didn't wrong. Okay, should be right because it is very important. If my name is Andi Swirta, please you write Andi Swirta, not Andi Swirto. Okay, or other. If my book written by 3%, please written 3% fully. But if my book written by 4%, please you write Andi Swirta at all, not DKK. Okay, I think it's very important in writing about reference, including also if you write about the source of from the book, please ensure the title of the book should be italic. Italic is partnering, okay? If the article in the journal should be italic, it's the name of journal, name of academic journal. If there is the undergraduate thesis, master thesis, or PhD thesis, please ensure should be italic is the undergraduate thesis, and then unpublished master thesis and unpublished PhD thesis, okay? Jadi kalau sumbernya dari skripsi, dari magister, dari tesis doktor, yang cetak miringnya adalah skripsi sarjana tidak diterbitkan. Magister doktor tidak diterbitkan. Disertasi doktor tidak diterbitkan. I have informed this to you, okay? Jadi kalau nanti makalah lengkapnya masih salah, nuliskan referensi, nah, berarti bolot nggak dengerin saran-saran saya ya, nanti dikurangi nilai makalahnya. Nah, jadi menuliskan sumber saja salah, apalagi membacanya. I think it is very important because it is the exercise for you, because you as candidate of the history scholars, okay, history educators and historian. I think one of the criterion if we want to be good scholars should be patient, okay, should be fervent, I think, in writing, okay. Please, what is not wrong in writing something, including also in writing the authors and editors about our reference. I think it's very important. There are my criticize, my suggestion, and my recommendation today, and let's ending our lecture by virtual meeting today by reciting together also Alhamdulillah. Alhamdulillahirrabbilalamin. I think this is the maybe the last meeting, okay? Because in next week, maybe in last week, you must collect the full paper, okay? Full paper, and please sending to my email. So maybe in next week I will give the closing lecture or also others activity. We still have in the next week. All students must collecting and then sending the full article, full paper related to your topic based on your choice of self. I think it is very important. Please also ensure that my criticize, my comment, my suggestion, my recommendation should be attention. I think it is very important. So hopefully your explanation in your article, there's the analysis in academic matters, and should be also supported by at least 10 sources, okay? Whether the books, standard book, or the article from academic journal. Okay, thank you very much. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Thank you very much, sir.
Okay, you're welcome. Okay.